to join us for that. And then I think without any further ado, I'm going to turn it over to the amazing teachers who
are
gracing us with...
Thank you very much,
very good.
Thank you. Mike Burbank has been working with Menla from the beginning when we first were given Menla, the Tibet House was, in order to create a space for the medicine Buddha. In case some of you don't know this, behind us is the medicine Buddha. He turned blue when he thought about human suffering. And he radiates blue healing light for people. And there's a whole story about that, which I might talk about at some point. And Mike has been working with us ever since that time. He was a student at Columbia originally, and he's really very valuable here. He has a lot to say about what this valley is like, and he's found caves here, and met the bears, he talked to the bears. If you see a bear, don't worry, and don't run away from it, but there occasionally is a bear. But I think you were told to take a hike, right?
I scared off the bears last week.
There was a young bear that was coming around, hanging out, and he told him to take a hike. So I'm very welcome very much. The bear was apparently neither depressed, anxious, or addicted. So he didn't need our services. He didn't need our services. He was just looking for our garbage. So, anyway, I'm very, very happy to see you all here. And I'm delighted you are gracing the new chairs with you. These are the maiden voyage of these chairs. So my wife is very interested in your feedback, whether you like the chairs, those of you who are sitting in chairs. And I'm particularly delighted to have Mark here as ever, my neighbor here in Woodstock, and my shrink, my, although he's still failing to cure me of either my depression, anxiety, but we're still working on it. That's the key point. We're still working on it. And I think Mark will start off. He has a wheel of life here. You actually made it up yourself.
Yeah.
Wheel of life. Fantastic. Yeah. So he's going to start off with that, and then I will lead us in a meditation about selflessness. Maybe we should start, though, first, just to take a moment's meditative break. If you look behind me at the medicine Buddha, the word Menla is a Tibetan word that means the medicine, actually medicine teacher, but it's the name of the medicine Buddha, Buddha when he teaches medicine. And there's a sort of special Tibetan Menla meditation that we do, that we encourage people to do. So why don't we do that for about just briefly, very, very briefly, if you go into what I call meditative mode, and in those chairs, if they're really comfortable, since they're so comfortable, you might pass out, and in that case, that's fine, you probably need the rest. And but otherwise, sort of, if you're sitting in the chair, cross the ankles, and put the hands in your lap, and try to be a little straight, and be comfy, you know? And your chin a little bit tucked, and the crown of the head a little bit pulled up by a silver string, sort of, like from heaven. And mouth closed, breathing through nostrils if possible, eyes half closed, with a sort of focus a little bit in front of the tip of your nose. And then breathing evenly and normally. That's kind of the rough meditational posture. And then what you do is you turn your attention back into your own face, as if looking for your face, for yourself, your identity, whatever, like you were looking, as if you were looking inquiringly into your mind and body. And when you do that, seeking to find your true self, you normally feel a little disoriented because you're not sure what you're finding when you become a mirror to yourself, so to speak. And that's good. In this case, you know, enjoy the disorientation and kind of let your, you know, self-image and your environment image, world picture kind of melt away in a sort of comfortable uncertainty. And then arise in a very focused, balanced, peaceful feeling and mood, and visualize in the sky above you. Forget about the roof, as you're looking with your third eye and the forehead, and visualize in the sky above you a sapphire radiant blue medicine Buddha, surrounded with a host of healing beings, and all looking and benevolently at you, smiling and radiating light to you, energizing and healing light, and but delighted that you are making this moment of focus on such beings. You can throw in Hippocrates and Galen and any kind of healing people that you know of in any culture, Ayurvedic people, Chinese medicine, Western medicine, Greek medicine, modern medicine. And as the light flows to you, you feel brightened and energized, and your worries and depressions and anxieties and things seem to be kind of glowed away from you, and you feel kind of bright and energetic and radiant yourself. And then imagine that around you, and it is not only the rest of us in the room, but a huge host of beings. And in with your loved ones in the front rows of the left, and your just a sort of neutral acquainted ones on the straight ahead, front rows straight ahead, and your unloved ones a little bit to the on the front rows of the right, those who you don't particularly want to think as being present. All of them looking at you and feeling surprised and astonished because they see you glowing. And for their different reasons, which I won't elaborate to keep it brief, they're all happy about that, even the enemies, even the rivals, to see you glowing. Rivals are a little jealous too, but they're happy too. And so then you just bathe in this sort of, you receive this radiance from these healing, the host of healing beings, any doctors you've ever known and appreciated, and colleagues, and whatever it might be, if you are a doctor yourself, and then sort of healing angels and medicine Buddhas, and then around you all these beings that you're aware of, when you reflect this light to them, and that, and then they send you back a kind of pleasure in that, and a gratefulness, and as you send that gratefulness to your mentors, teachers, past people who you felt have communicated to you something about loving and healing energy. And you create a setting like this, you create a sort of set like this about yourself, your own image of yourself, as a meditative self in this case, and a setting of the beings around you, those needing your help and those giving you help, both sort of connected with you with a flow of light. And our ideal at Menla is that somehow everyone would know this by osmosis, and the minute they would reach Menla, they would feel they were in such a field, such a healing field, and they were part of it, and they were sharing in the dedication of being such a healing being. So this is the Menla meditation, and you can, and don't worry if you're not a good visualizer and you just kind of have an image of maybe some doctor you once knew, or Hippocrates, or the Buddha, or Ayurvedic healer, or whatever it might be. You just have a flash image of that in your mind, then you just sort of imaginatively know that this host of supportive beings is there. And you imaginatively know that all these other beings who you are connected with are have you in their awareness in some way or another, and in a way do look to you. And what happens in your mind as you learn and as you share with others here affects their minds. So this is kind of the Menla vibe. It's a brief introduction. Over to you, Mark.
Okay.
Dr. Mark.
So I also want to say how special this is for me to be here at Menla, a place that I love, and to be teaching with Bob, a person who I love. We've been teaching for a long time now. I've lost track of the years, but since you came to Columbia and invited me once to come teach with you a little bit, we've been doing this once or twice a year. Some
version of this. I didn't invite you to Amherst when you go to Barry.
No,
because I didn't know you.
You didn't know me then.
I see.
So we've done various permutations of this over the years, and I always learn something from doing it, and I hope that you will from our collaboration. For those of you who don't know me or my work, I'm a Western-trained psychiatrist, which means I went to medical school, I did a psychiatric residency, and I've had a therapy practice, seeing patients in New York 4 or 5 days a week, 8-10 people a day, for the past 30 years or so. But I had the good fortune, before I had really any Western training, before I knew anything about Freud or drugs or psychiatry or anything, I found the Dharma, and I became interested in Buddhism when I was still in college, and through some kind of luck met a number of early American Buddhist teachers who took me to India with them, and Burma and Thailand and so on, and took me on retreat here in America. So the Buddhist thing for me somehow came first, and then that gave me enough confidence, I think, really, in myself to undergo the Western training. So I always was looking at the Western psychology, Western psychiatry, Western psychotherapy through some kind of Buddhist lens, because that's really what touched me first. And after some time during my Western psychiatry training, I started to write a little bit, just trying to figure out kind of basic concepts for myself, because I found that the having to write about it for me to actually put it into words what my understanding was really helped me make sense out of it, because the language that was being used always, in both camps, ego, self, emptiness, egolessness, selflessness, were the same words, but I was never sure if the Western ego that we were building up in psychotherapy was the same ego that the Buddhist teachers were saying was an illusion, or if the self that seemed to be necessary, for me anyway, was the same self that the Buddhist teachers were asking me to deconstruct. So I wrote a number of early papers that I published in an obscure California Journal of Transpersonal Psychology on ego, egolessness, emptiness, meditative transformations of narcissism, psychiatric complications of meditation practice, all that kind of stuff. And then later someone approached me to saying, oh, I heard your articles are sort of interesting, maybe you could actually write a book. An editor at a publishing house, Basic Books, encouraged me to write what became my first book, which is this Thoughts Without a Thinker, where I tried to put this stuff together in a more accessible way. So in terms of this weekend's program, anxiety, depression, addiction, which we made that a topic because Michael actually said every year he got a lot of requests from people asking, couldn't we just talk about those subjects because that's what people really needed help with. So we were like, sure, we can talk about those subjects. So what I want to emphasize from the beginning is that we're not in this weekend's presentation going to challenge various Western approaches that work or don't work for the treatment of any of those conditions. I'm, as a psychiatrist, I give antidepressants for depression, and I give medicine for anxiety, and I teach stress reduction when it's appropriate, and I encourage people to go to AA for their for their addictions. So I'm not going to suggest that that Buddhism has or should have, you know, all of the answers for all of those conditions. But I do want to talk about, and I hope that I know that Bob will talk about, what is special to the Buddhist psychological and philosophical approach. What can complement what we know from, you know, basically 100 years of Western psychotherapy, Western psychology, what Buddhism has that the Western psychologists haven't yet totally figured out, and then how maybe to make those things work together. So we're going to get, I think even starting tonight, we're going to get to the most fundamental aspect of Buddhist psychology, which is the what's sometimes called the intrinsic identity addiction, or the intrinsic identity habit, or the self-preoccupation, the self-habit. Various times when we've been teaching, I've heard Bob talk about one of his early Mongolian Tibetan teachers, who Bob confronted about this issue of, is there a self or is there not a self, or is the self real or not? And I should let him tell the story because he tells it better than I do, but I like it so much. His teacher said to him, you know, it's not that you're not real, or it's not that you Westerners aren't real, or that the self isn't real. Of course, you have a self, you know, you're different from that person, etc. But the problem with you guys is that you think the self is really real. You know, you think you're really real. So that bit of really real is, I think, what we're already in the introductory meditation, when we're turning the attention back in a mirror-like way, looking for your own face, that search for your own self. And what is that we're looking at and for, and who's doing the looking, and so on? That question is fundamental to Buddhist psychology, and it's fundamental, I think, to as an underlying aspect of anxiety, depression, and addiction. So I'm going to get into one of the things that I love about Buddhist psychology, which is their vision of the wheel of life. But I thought it might be, if it's okay with everyone, if just to have a sense of who's here, if we just went around just very, very briefly and said, you know, who you are, why you're here, what you do, that kind of thing, be helpful for everyone, since we're going to spend the weekend together.
Oh, hi. Okay, thank you. Hi, I'm Laura, and say last name too?
It doesn't matter. I'll forget your name immediately, okay. So we'll have to do
that. I'm here because I saw this second. I was going to go to there was a workshop in June on detox and cleansing, and then I saw, and I thought that was going to jumpstart my recovery to get back off an old drug friend of mine, Adderall, which is really, for me, amphetamine. But I didn't go because I was not ready. So, and then I said, if I have, you know, when I do like 33 days, then I'm going to go to this program. So, but the combination, you know, the anxiety, depression, you know, addiction, and the Buddhist way, the Buddhist light, this draws me here.
Good.
Thank you.
Excuse me. I'm Terry, and the reason I came is I've been in recovery from alcoholism for a pretty long time, and meditation has helped me with a lifelong struggle with depression, like this, I call it that, dysthymia. I've never been diagnosed, but that's pretty much what it is. And so after having read that book, and I knew that if I ever had a chance to come to something like this, and I've read a few articles that Robert Thurman has written, that I would do it. And so I was going through Tricycle Magazine, and saw luck. about 12 days ago, so I came.
Good. Well, welcome.
Thanks.
My name is Jason, and I'm a drug addict and an alcoholic.
Hi, Jason.
And it's fine. It's my number one response whenever anybody says their name. It also means that I'm a person in recovery. My Buddhist practice has been an essential part of my recovery. I will say that, interestingly enough, I've spent probably the last, 7 or 8 years falling asleep to the two of you talking to me because I own the PBS version of the Buddha. Uh-huh. And I looked at iTunes the other day and I've watched it over 1,000 times. Uh-huh. There's great peace in it now. I don't really hear it anymore. It's just kind of like, oh great, I can fall asleep. Yeah. But when it came through my social media feed, I signed up and subscribed.
Good. I have a friend who can only sleep if he plays The Sopranos on
I'm learning, though.
Because it goes,
I'm learning to sleep without the TV.
It's up to you.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, my name is Maya. I'm from New York. I'm actually here learning more about the Buddhist lifestyle. I'm actually a journalist, so I'm covering Menla and learning more about you guys and writing about this retreat. Hi, my name is Stacia. I'm here from Florida. I've been in active recovery for 5 years, and about the same time I started sitting meditation practice. And I was actually inspired by a Netflix video that I got of Robert Thurman speaking at Columbia. I don't remember even putting it in my queue, but it ended up in my mailbox. So. And there I'm also facilitating refuge recovery meetings and Dharma talks.
Yeah. Hi, my name's Dan. I'm also in recovery, and I'm a scientist and an atheist, and the spirituality part of it has been a little difficult for me, and reading more about this system of beliefs and sitting practice has been helpful for me, so I'm trying to dig deeper. Mm-hmm.
I'm Deborah, and I'm actually here for the Iyengar yoga retreat. However, how timely that it's happening at the same time, because anxiety, depression, and addiction are all things I deal with.
Hi, I'm Carla, and I think I take any opportunity to listen and learn from you every time that I can, so this is one of those. And I think we're all kind of dealing with a degree of these issues that you're dealing with. Also, I just went back to school. I want to be a psychotherapist, and I'm looking forward to them.
Could you hear it okay?
Yeah, look, some.
Okay.
I'm Linda, and I'm here because I just returned from 6 weeks in Zanskar and Lay, opening a hospital in Zanskar that His Holiness the Dalai Lama opened.
Oh.
I went with 15 other people, and there was an Amchi on one side and Western medicine on the other side.
Okay.
And I'm Christian, so I was really, Buddhism was very foreign to me. And everybody that I met, I just fell in love with. I can't explain it. And so when I came back, I've been to Menla quite a few times before, and I just saw this, and since I was on antidepressant medication for about 35 years and stopped cold in 2007, I just said, oh, wouldn't this be a nice time to come after I've just finished that and to find out more about anxiety and depression.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm always interested in the intersection of Western and Eastern.
Hi, my name is Diane. I'm from New York City. My addiction is stress, and I'm here for media also, but because I'm in media, it's crazy, and my blood pressure has been going up lately more and more, so I wanted just to find out how to help cure myself. Sometimes I'm suspicious I'm suspicious of Western doctors. I want to find more about Eastern and what they have also.
Don't be bashful, Bob's part of hearing, so if you want him to hear, you got to really talk into
it. Hi, my name is Sebastian. Similarly to Carla, a great deal of intellectual curiosity on one side, but also
a significant number of people in my family have suffered from addictions, alcohol, drugs, a number of things. And having lived that so closely and having two kids that are at some point, relatively soon getting to teenage type stage, I want to build as much information and knowledge and tools to, try to help them out in the best way that I can as a father, as they keep growing up.
Hello, my name is Sandra, and I'm here for the Iyengar Yoga retreat. And I'm really, this is a bonus. Who doesn't have anxiety these days, So thank you very much.
My name is Olga. I came here also for the Iyengar retreat. And thank you for the bonus, I think was well said. And I'm very close to, I practice a 12-step program, so it's very good to, it would be great to be in two places at the same time, but I can't.
We normally have a cordless one, we just can't find it.
Hi, I'm Jackie. I'm an educational psychologist. I live in New York City as well. I feel like I've had anxiety and depression over the years, and I use my yoga practice to help manage those symptoms. And I often find myself in relationships with people that are alcoholics. Mm-hmm. So I was invited by a friend this weekend, and just good timing.
Hi, my name is Caitlin, and I've been practicing Soto Zen Buddhism for about 8 years. And I am going back to graduate school this fall to get an MSW and be licensed as a psychotherapist. And this seemed like a good jumpstart to starting school and bringing together these two passions of mine.
Thank you. Hello, my name is Vanessa. This is intellectual, personal. I'm a college professor. I teach, and my area of research is addiction. It's been a feature in my life and in my family. I'm happy to say I'm sober 16 years from cocaine. Depression's been part of my life. And your books, Mark, have been a feature in my life. The first one just hit me between the eyes, going to pieces without falling apart. So I've been following ever since, and discovered this really on Monday, and decided I can't afford this. I can't go, and I pretty much put it aside until I went to the doctor yesterday for the second time. One of those callbacks from the mammograms, and I heard they said what no woman ever wants to hear. So I go for a biopsy next week, and so I went home. And I called up.
Okay, we're glad you're here.
Thanks, I'm glad I am too.
Thank you.
My name is Marilyn Erickson. I'm a psychotherapist in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And I am hoping to get some tools to deal with a lot of people who have, my clients have anxiety and depression. I've been to Menla once before with a friend. And I wanted to come with my friend, and so we are here together.
Okay. Yeah. I'm Sharon from New York City. I'm a painter, and I have a daughter with severe depression and anxiety, and I'm looking for another way to think about what's possible for her and how I can talk about it in a different way, and it's pretty much so, your adult daughter doesn't really want to hear your suggestion, but I thought, if I get a different angle, the understanding of it, I'm also interested in that intersection of East and West.
Thank you. And bring it back out. Leave the liners. Wireless system.
You can't find it. We'll have it soon.
It doesn't really exist.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Barbara, and I'm here from California.
And I have just been on my own personal, traditional psychotherapy journey for the last 30-some years. And probably about 7 or 8 years ago, I got into what I would call a true crisis and started looking more at the psycho-spiritual side of getting better, healing, whatever, trauma, all that kind of stuff. So I just really, and I don't really love the mainstream medical model way of helping people with mental health issues. I'm also a mental health advocate and on the board of an organization that I'm trying to find ways to help people heal without just medicines.
Hi, my name is Jonathan. I'm from New York City. I'm an artist and I teach, and I'm very familiar with your books as well as the pilgrimages to Bhutan and is it Mount Kailash? Kailash.
Oh, the Kailash book. Oh, yeah.
So,
Blade wheel, microphone.
Yeah, I guess I'm here mostly for my own intellectual curiosity, as well as I have to teach Buddhism to students for the AP Art History test. Mm. And I found I've been dabbling with mindfulness meditation as a way to offset chronic workplace stress.
I'm sorry, didn't get that. Did you go to Kailash?
No, oh. I'd love to.
Okay.
He wants to come.
Okay. Hi, my name is Rita. I'm originally from Italy, but I live in the United States now. And I've been suffering from depression and anxiety for a while now. Not addiction. But I found that medications didn't help. I didn't take them. I didn't want to. Maybe that took me longer to recover from my depression. I've heard people, scientists and athletes, saying that addictions are genetic, and I don't believe in that. I believe it's environmental. So I hope you can somehow clarify this tonight, and I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
My name is Francisco, I'm from New York City, and I'm blissfully retired, and I'm here for R&R, but this is a big bonus in here, and a very important topic of discussion, especially in the news lately. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Tim. I'm also here for the yoga retreat. I'm very happy to say that I've seen both of you gentlemen speak in the past, and I wasn't expecting that we would be invited to participate in the evening programs, and I'm very grateful for that. So thank you very much for having us.
Hi, my name is Tom. I'm an addict. I keep relapsing, and my sister recommended this to me. She thinks I should, you know, be here. She's like, you're going, and that's it. I suffer from anxiety, depression. It's like comes with territory. So, you know, listening to you two gentlemen, hopefully I can get something out of this and, you know, change my lifestyle up. Because, you know, I just don't want to live like this anymore. It's just ruining my life. So, you know, I'm very happy to be here and listen to you gentlemen. And, yeah, hopefully this will be a great experience.
I hope so. Even if it's not.
It's gotta be. I'm having fun already, so food was good, and you know, that's a good start. So,
hi, I'm Carolyn, and I'm here with the Iyengar Yoga retreat. I'm leading it, and I'm addicted to samsara. So whenever I can get a Buddhist teaching, a teaching that it wakes me up again to, you know, because it really, I do feel left alone. I just cling to all the things that are, you know, relatively healthy. People wouldn't necessarily call them addictions, but I'm just very good, I think, at having minor addictions to make me happy. Ones that are not so harmful, but they're still addictions. So I'm really glad you're going to speak about this subject. Thank you.
My name is Mike. I'm a recovering addict and alcoholic and the director of Menla. And if people come here to heal, I must really need it because I've been here for a long time and I'm going to be here for a while longer. So thanks for being here, everybody.
Thank you, Mike. I've actually known Mike for about 30 years, and so it's always a bonus to see him. And today is my birthday, celebrating it with all of you. So I'm actually trained as a physician, but I don't practice. I actually help hospitals be more efficient and help doctors be better doctors. But I consider myself a student, so thank you for having us.
What's your name?
Flynn. Flynn, F-L-Y-N-N.
excuse me. My name is Ron LaFrance, and I just have the joy of graduating or retiring from college teaching after 30 years in one place. And most of my teaching or my career has been with drugs, of all strange things. When I was in college, I ran a drug center, and I graduated, and I went to Antioch and wrote a program up there and taught up there for a long time. And then I said, geez, I gotta get out of this drug field. So I saw a position as a family therapist in another college. And I said, that's it, I'm going. So I got over here and they said, well, we also want drug addiction. You know, marriage and family is nice, but we want you to do the drug addiction. So in many ways, I've had to work with drug addictions throughout my whole life. And one thing I've learned through all this is that there are many different ways to heal. You know, many different ways. Some that people don't want to try at all, and some other ways that they might be willing to try. So one thing I really discovered about everything I do is to look through and see the heart of that person. And all the other techniques really don't mean an awful lot. And I've taken so much from you, Mark, and you, I kept reading about this and putting all of this kind of stuff together. But, you know, if you don't work with your heart, I don't know how it's gonna work. And no matter what the methodology is, whether it's family therapy or addicted family systems or whatever it is, you gotta look at the whole picture, and I think I spent my whole life doing that. So I still have some time left. So I'm still gonna keep a few clients each week, but I'm going at a slower motion. So trying to keep myself healthy, and that's part of being here. You know, I wouldn't miss you two guys. It's the stuff that you do is just wonderful, and that's been very helpful to me.
Great.
Thank you.
I'm Leslie, and I'm here for the Iyengar retreat also. I've been to Tibet House and to Menla many times, and heard Mark and especially Bob talk quite a lot and learn so much, and so this is a bonus too. I'm also very interested in the subject of your retreat because I know a lot of people who have struggled with addiction and been helped by 12-step means. I have suffered from depression myself and was greatly helped by antidepressants, but even more so by study of yoga, study of Buddhism, and just generally in psychotherapy as well. So. I'm really glad you're doing this
program. Hello, I'm Katarina. I'm with the yoga people too, and here for the trees and the mountains, and because it's beautiful. And I'm just grateful to be here with everyone.
I too am with the yoga group. I'm Jane, and like she said, it's a added treat and a bonus to be with both of you because I've gone to your lectures, and it's just. I didn't know this was all going to happen, so this is great.
Hi, I'm Anne. I'm with the yoga retreat as well. And I'm very happy to be discovering this. I'm at the transition time in my life, and this is a really wonderful opportunity to discover something new.
Hi, I'm Catherine. I'm a social worker. I work with people that struggle with anxiety, depression, and addiction. I work in Bellevue Outpatient Mental Health Clinic that works with addiction as well. So I'm here to learn more on the Buddhist perspective of those ailments. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Monica. I'm a psychotherapist in Brooklyn, and I integrate Buddhist philosophy in my practice along with evidence-based practices, and the majority of my clients are suffering from anxiety, depression, and or addiction. So it's a really perfect discussion for me. And Thoughts Without a Thinker was my very first book on Buddhism like 15 years ago, and it's been a great path since then, so thank you.
Hi, my name is Amina. I'm a psychotherapist, specifically trained in marriage and family therapy. I live in Connecticut, but I'm originally from Pakistan. I'm working for an organization that provides opioid replacement therapy for heroin and prescription pill addicts. I'd like to be able to learn how Buddhism and Buddhist and meditation affects the brain and the body, and you know how those changes take place. So I'm hoping this is going to give me the introductory piece. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joanne, and I'm a psychotherapist in Princeton, New Jersey, and I too have had anxiety and depression. My son is mentally ill and has been for a long time, and one of the things that I would like to is a project for me is trying to let go of wanting to fix him and some of my patients, depending on what their situation, seems to evoke the fixer in me.
Hi, I'm Doreen. I'm in recovery. I'm an alcoholic and an addict in recovery. Also have anxiety, like right now.
just having anxiety right now.
Anyway, I'm glad to be here. I really like, been reading a lot on the teachings, and I love to read, so I'll be reading these books, so thank you.
Good job.
Hi, I'm Lynn. I'm a special educator from Manhattan. I'm here with two of my colleagues. We work in a private school. And recently our school has been very focused on teaching the staff and the children about mindfulness. Some of our older students study ancient India and Buddhism. And, you know, I probably have some New York City neuroses that can benefit from Eastern philosophy as well. So thank you.
Hi, my name is Abby. And Carol and I started meditation, transcendental meditation, going on almost a year now. And so this is just something that hopefully we could learn more and take back to our students. Unfortunately, in New York City, we have a lot of students with anxiety and teenagers who are depressed and hard on themselves. I have a teenager too who has anxiety, and hopefully I can take something back to him as well.
Hello, I'm Carol. I'm also a learning specialist living in New York City, working with children who have learning disabilities, anxiety, and ADHD, and hopefully we'll bring back some of your strategies to help them cope better with their areas of weakness. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Irit Grader, and I'm a veterinarian. I am, have noticed a lot of difficulties for my clients, for my pet parents. And one of the reasons that I'm here is that I'm interested in trying to see if I can help them with different techniques. The other reason is that right now in the veterinary profession, there is an increased awareness to mental health. There is a high level of anxiety, depression, and suicide. And I am very interested in developing a program to help diminish that or increase the mental health in my profession.
My name is Patrice, and I'm here because I love listening to Mark, and I love listening to Bob, and because I just did the course, the Courage to Be lectures that they had at the Tibet House, and then I made the mistake of reading Paul Tillich's Courage to Be, and now I'm not sure I really understand anxiety, so that's why I'm here.
My name is Jan. I live in New York City. I'm a long-term recovering alcoholic. I work in the theater world, and I'm also writing a book about bells, including the one you just rang, which is one of the most beautiful bells there is. I have attended a number of things at Tibet House and have wanted to come here, and this seemed like the right time to come.
My name is Barbara, and a couple of months ago I took a serious fall hitting my head and have hit my head twice since. So I take it I'm out of balance and need to wake up, so I'm here.
I'm Sabrina. I'm a child and family therapist. I've worked with kids and families for 30, 35 years. Past couple of years I've increasingly incorporated mindfulness and other approaches that were not initially part of my training into my practice. So if I come away with another idea or two, that will be wonderful.
Hi, I'm Christine. So I'm a Columbia grad three times over, so I know you guys from there. I'm enrolled in the upcoming classes at Nalanda in yoga psychology and contemplative psychotherapy. I'm in recovery, and I always feel like I'm on the extreme end of things because I've been, I've suffered really very dramatically over the last year, and I'm searching for real answers. And so I go to meetings every day. I study to become a yoga teacher. I practice yoga. I've taken mindfulness-based stress reduction. It's an extremely important part of my day. And I'm just looking for ways to integrate these things, not just for myself, but also so that I can lend it to the community that I'm part of. So I'm searching for answers. And, you know, you guys popped up, amazingly enough. I'm very thankful.
Thank you. So I'll do a little introduction that's a bit more personal than before of Jimba and myself. Just to give you a little idea of who we are besides being here in our professional capacity. Jimba grew up as a nomad in Tibet and then became a monk and grew up in an environment where everyone was happy and stable and relaxed and spent their whole day following yak around. So practicing with Westerners and now moving to New York has been a big shift for him. So part of the reason that we're here is to really help me help him to translate the tradition a bit more and to help him understand more about working with Westerners. And his training in his tradition has been really robust. He studied in Tibet as a monk, the medical tantras, and then in India he did an intensive internship under His Holiness's Holiness Dalai Lama's current personal physician. Lenses for thinking about mental illness are very, very different in his tradition. And so we're hoping to kind of expand on that. I am his wife and translator. I came to the Dharma, 12 years ago, as mostly looking for answers to anxiety and my own, dealing with my own history of trauma. And I've been studying intensively ever since and derived great benefit from both Tibetan and Western traditions and approaches to mental health care. And so we're both really grateful to be sharing this weekend with these two wonderful teachers and with all of you, and thank you all for being so so open and letting us join you.
You have beautiful voice.
I am Danielle, and I'm from, I live in Brooklyn. I grew up in New York, and I feel like I'm surrounded by addiction and what else? I am an artist. I'm around a lot of, I tend to date addicts. I think that I'm just curious in the process of meditation, I found great stability, and I can breathe through it, and it helps with anxiety, like the anxiety I have right now. And it's been really transformative the past year. And I've heard both of you speak at Tibet House, and I'm excited to be here. Really grateful. Thank you.
My name is Lorena. I work here at Menla, and which is such a gift. And I've been in recovery program for about 13 years. I was living in New York City for about 16 years before I came up here, so that was pretty stressful. And like I said, this is a gift. And I also was a member of a sitting group in New York City, Dharma Punks, as well. And that was really helpful for me. And I had a Buddhist teacher there from Dharma Punks who combined Buddhism, psychology, recovery, and also addressed like childhood trauma. So it was really helpful for me to have that kind of holistic approach. So I was really excited to see this program here at Menla. You know, I love Menla, and so to have this here too is such a gift. Anyway, so really happy to be here. Thanks.
My name is Ellen, and I'm very happy to be here, and thank you very much. I have just completed a yoga teacher training program myself, and felt that this was, I've done a lot of reading of what your books that you've written, and I found it fascinating. I thought any subject that you wanted to share with us, I'll sign that up and be here for it, although the subject matter is extremely interesting and important personally to me as well. My son is a philosophy student at Columbia, and ever since he started college, I have been sort of really pushing myself to find my own path and my own, you know, way of studying, ways to study, and I found it. And so this is one part of it, and I'll keep going from here. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Anne, and I'm an Eastern medical practitioner and also a psychotherapist. And I run a couple of acupuncture detox clinics for people with addiction. And I work somatically with people. And I come to psychotherapy more from an Eastern medical direction, and I found the Dharma myself through a near-death experience, and Eastern psychology gave me a lot more information about my own experience, so that's, I'm here to rest and relax and enjoy my life. And I've also so appreciated Mark's bringing Western and Eastern thought together.
Hi, I'm Sarah, and let's see. This is the second retreat I've been to at Menla. I went through a crisis a couple of years ago and found myself in a recovery program for children of alcoholics and dysfunctional families, which broke open a whole spiritual side of life that up to that point, everything had been intellectual. So my heart opened, and then wintertime, it was with Bob and Sharon Salzberg, 5 days, and that sort of further breaking open there. And so since then, I have been following what Nalanda's been doing and coming to classes at Tibet House, and actually moved upstate, and you know, a lot of changes have happened. So it's just, you know, perfect for me this weekend, and I've really appreciated both of your books. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is also Sarah. I'm also here for my second time, and my first retreat here was with Bob and Sharon. Maybe I don't have to be here. I feel like this is redundant. I very much wanted to be here. I've been in recovery for a long time, and I've been a Buddhist for a long time. I teach Buddhism,
I practice Peruvian shamanism. I'm a teacher and a healer. And I have a little institute in Rhode Island called the Providence Institute. Recently, for a few years, I've been stuck in a way. I feel like my institute is stuck because I'm stuck, and it has something to do with I'm still not convinced that better is better. Like, why do I want to get better? What's there? What's what's better than this? And when this sucks. So last time I came to Menla, I was greatly recharged and inspired. And it seemed like an ideal topic for me. I've been a huge fan of Bob for years, and Thoughts Without a Thinker was the book that actually got me committed,
got you committed to wanting to be better.
After I bottomed out on alcoholism and I had dropped out of college, and Thoughts Without a Thinker was the book that got me committed to entering college again and finishing. Your lucid explication of the six realms especially made a huge amount of sense to me and has inspired me since. So thank you.
Thank you, Sarah.
Hi, my name's Rory. I'm currently in medical school and interested in becoming a pediatric or adolescent psychiatrist. But I'm interested in bridging that gap between Eastern and Western medicine. Over the last 10 years, I've been really lucky to go to high school in India, and then I lived in Noorpalinka, which is right outside of Mukludganj, for the majority of last year with the Khazars, who are Tibetan doctors. So I really see the value of both realms, and so I asked my friend Cole, who I practice Ashtanga yoga with in New York City, if she knew of any, she's a therapist, and I asked her if she knew of any psychiatrists that I could talk to. She said, well, you should look up Mark Epstein's book. And so I Googled it, and up came this retreat, and dragged her with me.
Actually, what you asked me was, are there any psychiatrists that I would recommend? And I said, well, you could read Mark Epstein's books. So my name is Nicole Breck. I'm a psychoanalytically trained therapist, social worker in New York City. I'm Ashtangi, and I decided to come up with Rory. But personally, I'm about to sit my first Vipassana course. So it's a 10-day silent class. And I only like to leave New York City by airports. So for me to be in the country and get ready for that retreat, I think it's going to be really intense. And so I was thinking about some things to prepare for that.
Yeah, this will be good preparation.
Yeah. Yeah. So no one can talk to me.
Okay. Thank you. Justin, you didn't tell us about your story.
I'm Justin. I have the pleasure of working here. Came to Menla 9 years ago. Hit my bottom here. Got sober on the insistence of my family here. So I've seen firsthand how magical this place is. So it's just such a blessing to see this happen. If you guys need anything, I'll be here recording. And yeah, I do the social media for Bob and Menla. But my name's Justin.
Thank you.
Okay, you guys, thanks. Thanks for your patience. But that's really helpful to know.
It is.
It's really a nice thing. So, okay. So I'm going to talk about the six realms. In Tibetan cosmology, you know, this realm where we are, which is the human realm, is only one of six places, six realms that beings, sentient beings, can live their lives. So we're not going to spend the whole weekend talking about reincarnation, although we have in the past. But it's a fundamental tenet of...
We always will.
It's a fundamental tenet of Bob's take on Buddhism and many other people's takes on Buddhism, that this life is but one of many, and that we will, depending on our the state of our minds in this life, that will determine where we go next. And it, the traditional cosmology, there are six realms, the human realm being one, the animal realm being another, hell realm, of which there are many, hell realms being another. There's a wonderful realm of the hungry ghosts, or the pretas, which we'll talk about, which is not quite a human realm, not quite a hell realm. It's its own place, full of beings that are filled with inexhaustible longing, but they can't take in any nourishment. That relates to addiction. There's a realm of the jealous gods, and then there's a god realm. So one of the ways that I have liked to think about this cosmology is not just as a description of places that we might go after we die, but that it's a description of states of mind that we're all passing through in this very life. And that, you know, we're all not just capable, but we're all sort of mercilessly being cycled through these various realms. And the way it's depicted, we don't have a tanka of it here, but the way it's depicted is very interesting. It's called the Wheel of Life, but the Wheel of Life is set into the yawning jaws of Yama, the Lord of Death. So the Wheel of Life is held by death, indicating, you know, that a fundamental principle, which is that everything is temporary. Okay, so the six realms are in a circle. It's a mandala, held but in the jaws of death. There's a ladder, like in chutes and ladders. There's a ladder coming off of the human realm, which signifies the way to nirvana, the way to enlightenment, the way to awakening. And it comes out of the human realm, because the human realm where we all are is the best place to achieve enlightenment from, because it has the perfect balance of joy and suffering. The other realms are weighted in other directions, but the suffering itself that has brought most of us here today, that we're talking about under the rubric of anxiety, depression, and addiction. One of the beautiful things about this model is that the causes of suffering, which are depicted in each of the realms, the causes of suffering are also the means of release. So the thing that we have control over, which is the mind training aspect of meditation, the thing that we have control over is our perspective on our own suffering. And when we're in our normal self-preoccupied states, we look at it one way. And as we start to train the mind, which Buddhism is very good at, the instructions are very specific, and, you know, tomorrow especially we'll get into a lot of it. But as you start to train the mind, it becomes possible to shift the perspective on this very experience that we're all having. So the question over here about, do we have to get better, or do we just have to accommodate ourselves, not necessarily in a stoic way, but do we have to accommodate ourselves to the experience that we're actually having in this mind and this body? That becomes the question. So I've been on a number of silent Vipassana retreats. That's the Buddhist tradition that I've practiced the most, comes out of what's called Theravada Buddhism, which is the Buddhism that's still practiced in Burma and Thailand and Sri Lanka. for the most part. And the way it's been transplanted into the West are in these silent 10-day, 2-week, week-long, month-long, 3-month-long retreats where everything is slowed down and you try to bring mindful awareness to your sitting, your walking, your eating, etc. And there's no talking and no reading, and you're just meant to use your own experience as the fodder for your awakening. And I always smuggle a little notebook into those retreats just in case I get a good idea that I might forget, or I hear a teaching that's goes to the heart of something that I'm struggling with. Every 10 years or so, I'll open up the notebook when I'm feeling stuck in my writing or in my life to see if one of those little things that I wrote down might help. And what I discovered after 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, is that I keep writing down different versions of the same thing. Because every time I hear it, it seems so profound, and it's like I've never heard it before. But it's usually some version of, it's not what you're experiencing that matters, it's how you relate to it. And if there's one thing to take away from everything that I'm going to talk about all weekend, it's going to be that. It's not what you're experiencing that matters, because you really can't control what you're experiencing so much. We're cycling through these realms. Sometimes we're having joyful, godlike experiences. Sometimes we're tortured by anxiety or burning with rage, like in the hell realms. We really can't control what comes up, but we can control how we relate to it. And that's what we're going to be practicing together. So in the center of the mandala are three animals, a pig, a snake, and a rooster. And they're circling each other, the tail of one and the mouth of another. Do any of you know what they represent, the pig, the snake, and the rooster?
Attachment, aversion, and ignorance.
Attachment, aversion, and ignorance, right. Or greed, hatred, and delusion would be another way. The pig is usually ignorance, I think. The snake would be anger. And the rooster would be greed or lust or attachment, clinging. So they're going in a circle at the center of the mandala. They're driving the whole thing. The ladder is going off the human realm to signify that there is release. But the higher teachings, the Mahayana Vajrayana teachings that we'll be hearing more from when I let Bob start to talk, the fundamental principle there is that samsara, this is the wheel of samsara, the wheel of suffering, the wheel of life. Samsara is nirvana. Nirvana is samsara. In the elementary teachings, the preliminary teachings, the teachings for like young people, then they teach that nirvana is like away from samsara. That if you work to train your mind and conquer your mind and calm your addictions and make your anxiety dissolve, and when you're not depressed anymore and you get enlightened, then you get to leave the wheel and go to some poorly described transcendental place where nothing happens, which is one view of nirvana. Our commitment on this weekend is to disabuse any of you who might be thinking about nirvana in that way. Unless you need to. If you need to think about it that way and it's helpful, it's fine. But it's much more interesting and I think much more profound to imagine this world, this life, this mind, this body, that this very imperfect one that you feel stuck in, as already nirvana, as already enlightened, as but we can't see it because we're stuck in some way. Stuck in addiction maybe, stuck in depression maybe, stuck in anxiety maybe, or just stuck in self-referential thinking, which we would say would underlie all of those states. So,
Are you now departing into the Mahayana?
That I have long ago departed into the Mahayana.
Burma,
I was on
Burma will be deeply distressed.
No. My experience of the most awakened of the Theravada teachers is that they don't dispute any of this. They understand Burma, the inside of them. They have to keep quiet for the sake of...
Okay,
so anyway. So I just want to go through, it's interesting to pay a little bit of attention to each realm. I won't fill the space up totally, but if you reflect a little bit while I'm talking on your own experience, especially on the places in you where you know you might be stuck a little bit, then you can hear those stuck places are talked about in different ways in each of the realms. And I think in terms of the Western, especially psychoanalytic, psychotherapeutic traditions, they're pretty astute when it comes to talking about some of the particular problems of each of the realms. And I think the most helpful thing, and I think you can get this from either side, from the Buddhist side or from the Western side, is that the fundamental problem of samsara is the Sanskrit name for this wheel of life where people are stuck. The fundamental problem that could be talked about as with words like estrangement or dissociation, that no one is experiencing who they are or where they are, which realm they're in. No one is experiencing it without a little bit of fear, you know, without a little bit of distancing, without pushing away some aspect of their experience a little bit, so that things are scarier, things are more anxiety-making, things are more difficult than they have to be when you are able to shift your perspective enough so that you're not fighting with whatever the experience is. And that's a lot of what we're practicing when we practice meditation, which we'll do together. That's a lot of what we're practicing, just sitting here doing nothing, watching the breath, or listening to the sounds, or feeling your body. What you start to notice are the various ways that you're not quite there, that you're not quite doing it, that for some reason you're just like a little bit at odds with your experience. And gradually, in meditation, it takes a long time, but gradually you learn how to sit back a little bit into your own experience, even uncomfortable aspects of your experience. And when you're able to do that, those uncomfortable aspects actually become the way that you deepen your practice. So another sort of take-home message from all of this is this idea that the way out is through. You know, the way out, the way off the wheel, the way out of any place that you might be stuck is by going deeper into the experience. The animal realm is the realm of instinctual gratification. It's the realm of like hunger and sex and so on. It's the realm that Freud spent a great deal of time unpacking. Freud had amazing insights into how people get stuck in the animal realm. I think I have one good thing I wanted to read to you from Freud, if you can stand to listen to Freud. He's actually a great writer. This is Freud. What we call happiness, in the strict sense, comes from the preferably sudden satisfaction of needs which have been dammed up to a high degree. And it is from its nature only possible as a periodic phenomenon. So he's basically talking about orgasm here as the ultimate joyful experience. But and he's using this 19th century language of physics, which he sort of liked. The satisfaction of needs which have been dammed up to a high degree, and it is from its nature only possible as a periodic phenomenon. When any situation that is desired by the pleasure principle is prolonged, it only produces a feeling of mild contentment. We are so made that we can derive intense enjoyment only from a contrast and very little from a state of things. Thus, our possibilities of happiness are already restricted by our constitution. So that's interesting on a couple of levels. From the meditative point of view, there are states of, you know, sublime bliss and happiness that can be maintained for long periods of time. So he's not exactly right about that, because he read like early translations of Sanskrit scholars who brought stuff back to Germany, but didn't quite understand it. But even those states of prolonged bliss, those go in the God realm, but even those are temporary. They could last for eons, but they're still temporary. But what Freud's talking about relates more to the animal realm and to the human realm, you know, to addiction, which has brought a lot of you here. And I think what you find often in addiction is the first pleasure, you know, the first pleasure, the first time that you're drunk, the first time that you take a drug, you know, relief that it brings, and the happiness that it brings, the joy, the pleasure that it brings, is like the best thing that you've ever had, you know. And then it's never quite that good again. And there's this urge inside to try to reproduce that original experience, you know. And Freud's getting at that right away here, that we're so made that the intense pleasure that we're seeking, we can't make it last. So the addiction is right away, you're like chasing the tail of this thing that it just physiologically is not really possible. That's how people die from heroin, you know, because they just keep pushing it up and up. In each realm, inset into each realm is a little tiny figure of the bodhisattva of wisdom. I think it's Manjusri, right?
Inside each one?
Inside each one.
Well, it's the Buddha, actually.
Is it the Buddha?
Yeah. I will look at this for the Buddha of compassion.
Okay.
And manifesting in such a way that the beings in that realm will perceive them as a Buddha.
Okay. So, and it's in the mandalas, it's painted in, and in each realm they're holding a different instrument, meant to show what's necessary to change the perspective in that realm. So in the animal realm, the Bodhisattva of Compassion, Avalokiteshvara, is holding a book. Because what's necessary for the taming of the instincts is knowledge, self-knowledge.
I think
it's
a book in the human realm.
No, in the human realm is the Buddha himself, in his robe and... at least in the, I'm sure it's different.
Okay, where
different
was the
ones.
Book in which book?
The book's in the animal realm.
Oh.
According to my sources.
There might be a version like that.
There
a reading animal.
In the hell realms.
Or maybe you could say they put it in that painting to indicate that the animal, you know, would be better off to become human, but they could use the book.
Exactly.
So it's like bringing them to where they have
to
language.
Where they, yeah.
Because the animals don't have the language, because their suffering is described as anyonya bhakshana, one eating each another.
Mm-hmm.
So they're always devouring each other, so they have no time to chat.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
Or I'm behind someone getting you. So that mm-hmm. so the book might be encouraging them to think about it instead.
Yeah.
Start to think.
Yeah.
In that particular painting.
Yeah. Because in fact, some animals do have language.
What?
Some animals, it turns out, do have language and are already rising.
Well, of course they have language, but
yeah.
But they don't read.
They don't read.
Without a thinker.
No, not yet.
Although actually there are Sthiramati, there's a story, the great Indian master Sthiramati.
Mm-hmm.
It is said that he was a parrot in a previous life, not very long before his life, who would belong to Vasubandhu. And Vasubandhu was a Theravadin, a great scholar, and his brother Asanga was a Mahayanist. And Asanga gave him this huge load of books that Asama had written, and then all the Mahayana sutras at that time, what they had. And he said, as my brother, because they're into like brotherly piety, you know, in India at that time. So then Vasubandhu, he got himself in a bath of warm sesame oil, where he would spend the day and read all these books. And the parrot, he read them aloud, and mm-hmm. the parrot would listen. And then the parrot was immediately reborn as a human and became a great professor. in India in the fourth, fifth century, they say. And there is a story like that. So maybe that's it. He was the one that was holding the book, you know,
and
the parrot.
And they have a treatment at the spa over here where you two can sit and warm sesame oil.
I don't know if they have the whole bath, I don't think so. Just rub down it. Because he had to get into sesame oil because it made him so nervous to read all these many books.
Yeah.
And the Sangha made him read. Yeah, he said, Sangha has sent me an elephant load of books, my elder brother, and I have to read them all now. So he had to get in the path to calm his anxiety. I'm sorry.
Good. Okay, so that's the animal realm.
Yeah.
So the hell realm, the Buddha figure holds a mirror. Because the thing about the hell realms is that people feel, and you and we know this when we're, at its most extreme in our world, it becomes paranoia, you know, when people can't handle the intensity of their own rage, they start to project it outwards and begin to experience other people as hating them the way they can't quite acknowledge that they themselves are hating. And that mechanism, that defense mechanism, basically of projection, takes place on a milder level in everyday, not crazy people. It's in its most intense form, you know, then you're completely taken over in one way or another. But the Buddha figure here holds up a mirror so that the hell beings themselves, when confronted with the mirror, can see that the pain that they're believing themselves to be in are actually their own emotions. So, and that again, you get this sense of estrangement from the self, which is underlying all these emotional states. The hungry ghost realm is one of the ones that I'm most interested in, both from my own experience, which I've written about, and which when we have time tomorrow I can talk more about, and also from a lot of my patients. The idea in the hungry ghost realm is that there are these beings who are described, the anatomy is described beautifully, with long, very, very thin necks, and so thin that even swallowing a bit of water burns, because it's like one cell, that kind of thing. And big bloated bellies, so empty bellies, beings who are craving nourishment, filled with a sense of inexhaustible loneliness or emptiness. But they're so frail, then their anatomy is such that they can't really take in any present-day nourishment. So there's a ghost-like feeling to the hungry ghosts.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but
go ahead.
They're not ghosts, they are actually born beings.
Yes.
And that hungry ghost translation came from through the Chinese, the way the Chinese translated it, and then it got kind of stuck in Western language.
Interesting.
Because the preta is the word, right? Preta.
Yeah.
And it isn't a ghost, it's a kind of animal, and it's between hell and the animal.
Yeah.
Right? And especially the characteristic is frustration and starvation.
Yeah.
And thirst. But it isn't, the ghost makes it sound like, unfortunately, like some sort of being that could be dealt with more easily because you sort of exorcise the ghost,
yeah.
Get them to be reborn somewhere. But it just got from Chinese.
The only reason I like the ghost part, and I get that it's not originally there, but from a psychological point of view, we see this in therapy all the time. People who are looking backwards into the past, trying to get some deprivation, some abandonment that they've experienced.
Well, yeah, you can
That's the only reason that I'm
emphasizing. The point is, in the Buddhist cosmology, there are actual ghosts who are stuck in a life that they died from, and something, either hatred or some intense emotion, or the people they're still engaged with, or the objects they're engaged with, then they stay in the between state,
mm-hmm.
constantly dying, being reborn, and then they are, but they might not be hungry.
They might not be pregnant.
Because they don't have stomachs. You know, they're like a subtle body beings, like a dream being.
Yeah.
But they're just obsessed with some situation in the life they left.
Mm-hmm.
And they are such beings, according to them. And the Chinese sort of mixed up with the idea of a preta.
Mm-hmm.
That's my point. But the preta, problem with the preta, is the person is born there and stuck there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're not looking on at the human life, they're just really starving. They don't even remember the human life. And then, you know, the three poisons,
mm-hmm.
Those three realms below the human, the animal is from excessive stupidity or delusion, the preta is from excessive lust and greed, and the hell is from hatred.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if a human dies with any one of those things too predominant, that's unfortunately where they go.
Right.
So that's connected.
Right. And that goes for just in this life too. If your mind is filled, you know, with one or the other, then that's the realm that you're mostly stuck in,
right.
even in this world. The Buddhist.
They say, by the way, that for a human to find out where they were before, if they were in one of those lower realms,
yeah.
is you get them drunk. Mm-hmm. And then when they're drunk, if they're greedy, they want to eat like a lot of ice cream
mm-hmm.
or something, then they might have been a preta.
Uh-huh.
If they want to fight, then they came from hell.
Uh-huh.
And if they just kind of go blah, then they might have been an animal.
Interesting.
They say that's a Tibetan thing, that's a folk thing. Just let your patient nice and drunk and see what they do. And then you know how to handle it.
That's
Angela's laughing.
So the Buddha figure in the hungry ghost realm carries a bowl filled with spiritual nourishment, because it's only spiritual nourishment that can awaken
mm-hmm.
that can awaken the preta, which is why coming here is good. You know, if any of those qualities are there in you, then if we can convey anything worthwhile, then that sense of emptiness, that sense of
mm-hmm.
You know, too much separateness and aloneness, the people who were talking about getting into relationships with addicts and so on, often this mindset, this emotional stuff is underlying that, because you're trying to fill up something that can't really be filled by merging too much with another needy person.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm assuming you read Gabor Marte's In the Realm of the Hungry Ghosts.
I did not.
Okay, so he talks about heroin addiction in Vancouver. Uh-huh.
He talks about in the Hungry Ghosts is actually really stemming from trauma. And I wonder if you see it the same way, so that they're so traumatized they can't take in any love,
yeah.
and they can't take it in anymore.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to try and talk about that tomorrow. There's a whole sense of developmental trauma, which is like trauma that happens early in life that we talk about in therapy a lot. And that often people who have had that experience end up emotionally in places like we're talking about here. Yes, absolutely. The God realm, you can sort of imagine, the God realm is filled with beings who don't have to have bodies, or maybe they have very subtle bodies. And they can be there for very long periods of time, just, you know, sort of suspended in pleasurable feeling. There's death from the God realm. When your time there runs, when your karma runs out, your time there is gone, but there's no like getting sick like we get sick and where we have to deal with dying and so on. They just immediately plop, they're gone into the next realm. They go in an instant. The Buddha figure there is playing a lute. The lute is like the bell, which is meant to wake the God beings up from their trance-like slumber, because their time is temporary and they're not working on themselves. You know, they're too busy luxuriating in the pleasures that they've earned from wherever they were before. But at some moment, after 9/11, I worked with a wonderful woman whose husband was in the towers and died. And he was a very wealthy banker and so on, and his office was all the way at the top of one of the towers. And we talked a lot about how he was like in a god realm. You know, he'd been in a god realm his whole life. He had tons of money, and he had a boat and a house in the Hamptons, and he loved to shop at Hermes, and he went in an instant, you know, just like, just, but that helped her to think about it like that. It gave her a way to understand that we all die in different ways. So what else? The jealous god realm. The god realm and the jealous god realm are separated by a wishing tree, and the wishing tree grows delicious fruits that if you can get one, then your wishes come true. So the jealous gods are fighting the gods for the fruits of the wishing tree. And that I think of this realm as like the realm of the ego. And that ego psychology and cognitive therapy and so on, all the therapies that have been developed to strengthen the ego, which is a necessary thing, are working in this realm, trying to get the jealous gods off of their competitiveness, because they're fighting over the wrong things, you know, and they could be strengthening their own minds. And mindfulness, meditation, for instance, that we've already started to talk about, that we'll do some together tomorrow, it, I think of really as an ego-strengthening exercise. Often people think that we're just eroding the ego, we're trying to get rid of the ego, but it depends, of course, on how you understand what an ego is, which I'm not sure anybody really does, but according to Freud, anyway, the ego is that which modulates or mediates between the inner world and the outer world, between the instincts and between the demands of external reality. So you need an ego in order to function, you know, in order to manage yourself. And one of the main things that mindfulness is good for is that it teaches you how to manage your emotional self. That's an ego function. And a very helpful one, especially for people who are struggling with all these conditions that we're talking about here, where they're kind of at the mercy of their emotional selves, whether it be addictive or anxious or depressed or anything else. And with the practice of mindfulness being an ego function, there's like strength given to this idea of self-regulation or self-modulation. And the Buddha figure here comes with a flaming sword, the sword of discriminating wisdom, which is sort of like the book in the animal realm, but it's meant to redirect the aggression from, fighting with your siblings over who's going to get the inheritance, to instead doing something, you know, to make yourself a better person. And then the last, and I'll stop after this, the last is the human realm, which, as I mentioned before, we're lucky to be here. It's the realm of the greatest opportunity. It's where you can get enlightened from this realm. For people who are not oriented spiritually, the highest aspect of the human realm is said to be that of creative expression. So it's where the artists are. But it's really the realm of the search for the self, or the problem of the self is inherent to the human realm. So we're going to spend some time talking about the self, you know, trying to find the creative expression artists are all about. Most art is self-representation, even if it's abstract. Artists are all about, you know, bringing the inside out. And we're doing some kind of, meditation is some kind of a formless art, where we're using the mind, using the heart, to go inside, to investigate, and to kind of cultivate or craft a better version. I don't know, I have to watch that language now, but a more enlightened version of ourselves. So in the human realm, for me, those of you who have read my work know that I'm devoted to this one particular British child psychoanalyst named Donald Winnicott. And Winnicott writes, and I'll be talking about him tomorrow on Sunday, but Winnicott writes about the difficulty of being both a parent or a child, that a growing child has to cope with either an intrusive or abandoning parental environment, and that the self is developed out of a kind of reaction to either the intrusion or the abandonment. That the good enough mother, which is the phrase that he coined when mothers were doing all the parenting, but the good enough mother, the good enough parent is one who gives the right kind of space. So doesn't over-abandon, doesn't over-intrude, and with that adequate amount of space, which, see, I think in meditation we're doing that for ourselves. We're trying to find the right kind of space to give ourselves. But the child who's given that right kind of space develops a continuity of self. And I use that phrase, going on being, for one of my books. That's a phrase from Winnicott. The child who has trouble finding that kind of space has to develop what Winnicott calls a false self, which is a self that he also calls it a caretaker self. It's a self that develops in order to handle the parental needs or the parental abandonment, you know, the space, the too much space or the too little space. So then that false self, which is like a defensive organization, doesn't feel real on the inside. So then there's a struggle that Winnicott talks about between the false self and some notion that there might be a truer version somewhere. And that can either lead someone on a spiritual search for the true self, or it can lead someone into the various places that many of you have talked about. Because a lot of what happens in substance use and abuse is people are actually trying to get rid of that sense of the false self, because it's uncomfortable. And if you're getting your patients drunk, you know, you can, when you get your patients drunk, you can find out who they were before. So it takes away, a lot of the substances take away the pressure of this defensively organized false self. The Buddha figure in the human realm comes in the form of the historical Buddha, Shakyamuni Buddha, who went through a whole process of trying this, trying that, getting depressed, getting anxious, trying, you know, becoming anorectic, until he finally found what he called the middle path, which was the right amount of space for himself. And out of that, you know, he was able to find his way home. That's what we're going to talk about for the next couple of days.
Okay, a little further, you have a little, what time is it?
It's like 9:15 already, 9:15.
9:15?
Yeah.
Okay, just a few minutes, because I think people will be tired.
Yeah.
I thought maybe we would start the evening on this session, coming back to it tomorrow, the two meditations, which we'll do together. And since we're in the human realm, and we can think, very lucky, we will try to meditate a little bit. The first one is kind of very radical meditation on selflessness, which is and there's a special precept about it that comes from the Atisha, some Indian master, famous Indian master of the century, supposedly, but it's a personal kind of oral precept. And then although it's found in some of the writings of the Dalai Lamas. And then there is the Lama Dzongkhapa, who was a very famous one in the early 15th century. And but it's sort of a personal one. And the only place it's written that I know of is in the writings of the Panchen and the Dalai Lama, who were students, the first one of which, first Dalai Lama, both the first Panchen Lama, first Dalai Lama, were students of Dzongkhapa. So go into meditative mode. We'll quickly do this together. We'll just go through it. Something called the three keys. I will talk about in terms of three keys. Usually it's four keys. We'll talk about in terms of three keys. And the most important of God is the first key. So the idea in the first key of the meditation on selflessness, which is considered which is same as emptiness, like the famous emptiness, which is considered the most important meditation, because meditations of, sort of calming your addictive emotions and addictive ideas, to become more, give yourself more space, not to be less sort of appetitive, and to be less paranoid and aggressive. Those meditations will be very beneficial, but they will not liberate one from from the core of suffering, which comes from delusion. The only thing that liberates one from delusion, which is the only thing that liberates one from suffering, is wisdom. And wisdom doesn't mean some sort of mystic sort of oneness notion. Wisdom means truly realistic experience of reality, which you are, Buddha insisted you were capable of. As I think psychotherapists insist that too, that people should be more realistic. And so the first of those four keys is very important, because the expression selflessness means that the reality, it's a kind of report, you could say a scientific report by the Buddha, that a certain kind of self is missing, is lacking in a living being, and a human being, all living beings and human being. But this particular kind of sense of self, or self, is assumed to be present in the being. And this is the core of the delusion. In other words, if one thinks, that's what Mark already mentioned wonderfully, remembering the story about the Geshe Wangyal, where he said, people are not wrong thinking they exist or they're real, or even he would say that they have a self. But the problem is they think they're really real, they really exist, and they have a real self, like an absolute self. Or there's a lot of very sophisticated language in Buddhism, you know, an intrinsically real self, an intrinsically objective self, an intrinsically identifiable self is considered the most subtle level, something like an intrinsic identity, an identity that is there sort of on its own, that's independent, absolute, undeniable, you know, solid kind of, okay? This kind of self is this kind of self that we don't have. So now, but then what does that really mean? And this is the first key of meditating on selflessness, to begin to get a bit of an experiential or visceral feeling of what is that? Okay, if according to Buddha, if I'm not enlightened, perfectly enlightened, like a Buddha, it means that I have this idea of this kind of false self. I'm not sure quite how it fits, although it's false
self. It does fit, it fits.
The other kind of false self, yeah, that you mentioned. But this kind of false self. And this is therefore, the first key is identifying what this is, what it feels like, finding that I have it in my mental habit, in my sense of self, okay? And the way that you do this in this particular, as I said, personal, you know, guru to disciple tradition is, you remember, you're meditating now, I hope, and you remember an event in your past, could be recent, could be far in the past, where you were an innocent of something, and someone you cared about accused you of doing that something, having that something, being that something. In other words, you're in a moment, you must try to remember. And I guess they consider that everyone can find such memories where someone said, you know, you did this and so, how could you do such and such? You know, particularly emotionally powerful one is where it's someone you cared about. And they misunderstood the situation and they thought you did something and accused you for it, and actually you didn't do it. It doesn't mean remember a situation where you were accused of something and you did do it. Because you won't get the same feeling from that, a different set of feelings. But you actually were innocent in this case. You took my something, you did my something, you said something. Try to remember some incident where someone falsely accused you. And And there's a little bit of it, even a subtlety, a nuance in this meditational remembering, which is that the rememberer is should be a small portion of your consciousness energy. It should be like as if you were, you know, surreptitiously observing yourself in the event that you remember, so that your main consciousness tries to relive the memory. So you try to remember this incident with or you relive it if possible, which is I mean it is possible, but whether you can do it in some quick way, I don't know. They say take plenty of time. Normally, we don't have that much this evening, we're just introducing it. And this, if you think about it, if you find an incident like that, and if the person, you protest your innocence, from the feeling that you're looking for, you would then maybe rise in protest, that I didn't, I'm innocent, I didn't do that. What are you talking about? I didn't do that. I was, have an alibi of never. You know, and this is the feeling you had from which you spoke out protesting your innocence. And it's the feeling prior to another kind of feeling might have happened where you became indignant that the person thought that you had done this, and sort of then righteous and then angry might be sort of a sequence, a pretty normal habitual sequence. And what you want is the first feeling of injured innocence before you rise in indignant protest, if possible. You want to find that in a memory, then you want to really drill down into it and relive it. And you don't want to be thinking that, well, I'm looking at now a sense of self, a sensed self that feels undeniably innocent and is therefore very, very present. You don't want to be doing, I'm doing that in order to find out that it isn't there. You sort of bracket the next step, in other words, following steps. You want to feel as strongly as you can and as clearly as you can how much you really feel. There is that self there that's really innocent, that's really, you know, being hurt feelings, that's really falsely accused, and really purely innocent. And because of the innocence, it sort of comes out in your awareness strongly. So that when you do then rise to protest, I did not do that, the sense of the I really seems to rise out of your heart, out of your gut, like from something solid in your heart and gut. Try this, try to do this now. Find the memory, dwell in the memory. Only observe yourself from a little corner of the present and really get into the past memory. They say that when you know that you have achieved this key point, key insight, you feel so strongly your sense of inner presence, of your identity, your real self, your innocent so that you are surprised that, but you accept yourself, that you actually don't agree that you lack such a self. In other words, if Buddha walked in and said, oh, you don't have a real solid self in there, and if there's no core in your heart, in your being, you would feel not easy agreement, you would feel disagreement and challenge by that statement, selflessness. And when you realize that you have here a confrontation, if you will, with the teaching of selflessness and how you actually feel, that's when you have, you know, sort of achieved the first key, they say. And therefore, it takes time, because, you know, when you're meditating, this start with, and you're in the context of the Buddha's teaching, and you sort of are kind of inclined to try to experimentally go along. But that would be a mistake according to this precept. Because if you thought the object of your inner inquiry, your inner mindfulness, and by the way, the word we translate as mindfulness is only exactly the word in Pali or Sanskrit or Tibetan that means memory, actually. So it is the same thing. It's remembering something internal. So if you think that the object of the meditation on selflessness sounds like the object is selflessness, but actually the object is the self, and you can't really go looking for the self unless you strongly feel there's something to look for. You know what the term refers to. And so you want to find a referent in your inner experience, habitual, conditioned inner experience, inner cognitive field. You want to find what is referred to by the pronoun self. Freud would have used the pronoun ich, not the Greek ego, the German ich. The pronoun. So the meditation on selflessness, in other words, of which this is the first step in this system, in this tradition, is the identification of the self that we sense within ourselves. What Buddha would call the exaggerated intrinsic self that we feel is there, the really real one. We have to feel how we really do feel, we have to admit that we do feel that, and feel how it feels when it kind of comes most out to us, when we feel righteously innocent. And then, therefore, the quest of the reality of that situation is a inquiry where, in a way, one accepts the Buddha's challenge, the Buddhist psychologist's challenge, which is, okay, I acknowledge you feel that. You acknowledge to yourself you feel that way. I'm not telling you you shouldn't feel that way, just like an ethical thing, moral thing, or some kind of authority thing, that I know you don't have it or something, so you shouldn't feel that way. I'm not telling you that. I'm telling you that you have to start with the fact that you do feel that way. But maybe my challenge to you is, would you verify that? Would you care to really investigate and see if you really do find that self, or you really look for it? If you don't, please let me know. If you do, please let me know. Maybe my selflessness thing is itself an exaggeration. Maybe when I was in a bad mood. So, it's an open question. Do you feel it's really there? Buddha says it isn't really there. So you have to struggle with that. And the second key is that looking for that self, you will either find it and verify it and say, okay, here, this is it. I feel it when I'm in certain emotions and moods, and this, now I've found it. Or I won't find it. And I commit to my, you know, conventional awareness, practical awareness, that, you know, things are just either there or not there in the practical, you know, surface world, okay, where I live, relative world. It's either, you know, I look for an elephant in the room, it's either here or it isn't here. There's no sort of third option where it's sort of, its ghost is here or micro elephant's here or some kind of mystical thing. Practically speaking, this self that I feel is there in my gut, in my heart, in my solar plexus. Either I'll really find it there, or I won't. And I commit to that outcome, to the exhaustiveness of those outcomes. Before I kind of dive into my mindfulness and then my inquiry into myself, the status of myself. And the need for that is that when we do concentrate, focus, starting with mindfulness and going to more kind of one-pointed inquiry, you know, vipassana, samadhi, combining it more with sort of concentration, you can get lost in there. You are so complicated. We are, the living being, the human being is so complicated. So we want to have a practical outcome. Just like it's very practical that I feel I'm really here and I don't agree, that I lack a real Bobhood, Bob self in here, with what Buddha says. Not Arjuna says, Buddhist psychology says. Then the third key is, when we do it in a three-key way, not a four-key, a five-key. The third key is to look within the body-mind complex, the physical processes of the body, and the mental processes of sensations, recognitions, emotions, and consciousnesses, the complexity of the being when one mindfully investigates the inner field of awareness. Awareness ends, you know, complex inner field of awarenesses. And one is guided by, when there's only three keys, one is guided by what is called the key reason, called the royal reason of relativity. The self that I feel when I feel righteously innocent seems like absolute to me. And in that, and that's the best moment to observe it, when I have injured innocence. In a way, without having to remember, I can remember times I was furiously angry. And I was acting, I'm driven by that anger, I was acting out the anger. And when I was doing that, when I look back at myself, I realized I was behaving like I was absolute. The anger gripped me so completely, I had lost all restraint. I said things I didn't mean, I did destructive things I didn't regretted doing immediately, but because I was like out of relationship with a thing, people and things around me, I broke things I valued. I broke relationships I cherished. So I was like bull in a china shop. It was like that emotion gripped me and whipped me into action from a seemingly absolute place. But that's not necessarily the best thing to remember, because in those moments, you can't really remember the self, because you're kind of unconscious. If you go into drilling down in that moment, it will not be as fruitful as if you drill down in the moment where you first felt this injury of the false accusation and you were simply hurt before you exploded in some way or became indignant and angry and protesting and so on. But the reason of relativity is that since my inquiring consciousness, when I look inside, just like when I look outside and see flowers and trees and everything, is relative. I see something because I relate to it visually. I hear something because I relate to it audibly. I smell because I relate to it, the smell, olfactorily. I taste and touch things, relating to them. I mentally imagine something, or I mentally perceive something, or think something. I'm relating to those thoughts. I mentally have an image of something, I relate to the image. I mentally feel something, I relate to the feeling. The real reason of relativity is, if I can relate to it, it's relative. If it's absolute, it cannot be related to. So even if I feel something as an absolute, feeling it relativizes it, is the third key. So in a way, the first key is where I recognize that I do absolutize my sense of self. Or I have a sense that there's an absolutized self there. And I have to go all the way to where I really feel that. Then I accept a challenge and I look at it. And then whatever, if I find an aspect, it's relational. So I have to look deeper, and I have to look deeper, and I have to look deeper. Because I'm still feeling that beyond what I'm relating to, there's a real solid thing behind it. Do you follow? And I remember that I felt that when I did the first key. So then this puts me in a deep, inner, kind of dervish spinning of inquiry, looking for this solid object in there, in that consciousness that's looking, actually, as well. But that way, that's when we develop it further. Okay, ding, that's enough because of the time. You can't go further with that. I'm just giving you the area, because I wanted to inform our discussions.